Okay, over to you now.
Yeah, hi Mike. Thank you very much for a wonderful introduction, and thanks to all the organizers of CERI 2021. So here is the topic: verifying reactive system via symbolic execution with incremental deepening. So this is the TracerX group, and you can see the first photo is Professor Jokshan Jaffer, the second is Dr. Rasool, and the third one myself, and the fourth one is Dr. Arpita. So we are working in a group, TracerX, and I was doing my postdoc in NUS Singapore, and since then we are still continuing our collaboration. And the slides will be supplied to you, and you can contact us, let's say, if you have any questions or if you want to ask anything to us, okay? So basically, we are working on dynamic symbolic execution with pruning, and we call our tool as TracerX. And we have several applications, and we are still trying to keep on working to improvise our, let's say, technique. Okay, so it utilizes interpolation for such space reduction. So what happens? We have dynamic symbolic execution, which explores the execution tree. Means it searches for all the, let's say, feasible paths. But the thing is, if we want to, let's say, solve the problem of path explosion, then we can actually have this algorithm called as interpolation. And there are several, let's say, interpolation techniques have been, let's say, introduced. But in this particular talk, I will be explaining about the unsat core. So outline is symbolic execution. I will be explaining you about the system TracerX, then how unsat core interpolation can be computed, and the recent idea what actually we are trying to solve using iterative deepening. Means sometime we have let's say programs with infinite loop, but the thing is infinite loop will not be able to solve our issue. So how we can actually try to get the let's say try to process the infinite loop oriented program so that we can get more and more kind of, let's say, bugs, or we can have more let's say coverage. And we will see some results based on this particular idea. Now let us see symbolic execution first. So model program statement as constraint means we'll try to find the path constraint, okay, and we'll analysis of verification by traversal on symbolic execution tree. Means we will be let's say we will be virtually creating the symbolic execution tree, and how we will solve the path. We will send it to, let's say, constraint solver, whether it is feasible or not, it will get let's say computed, right? So let us take one example. You can see here there is a small program here. So context saying initially the x is actually greater than 0, okay, and there are three if statements here. The first if it is statement is saying, let me just annotate it. You see this one: if a is equal to 1, and then you skip, okay. Second condition says b is equal to 1, then you assign 0 to, let's say, c, and if c is equal to 1, then increment x with 1, okay. That's a very small program. But here, what is the dependency? You can see if b is actually equal to 1, then the value of c is getting let's say assigned with 0. It means then the then body of c is, this particular condition c is equal to 1 cannot be possible. So it always will go to let's say s body of that. So this is what the let's say constraint, how we are actually going to solve, and this infeasibility we will be able to show you. So this is what symbolic execution tree, how it works. I will be explaining you from the let's say leftmost path of the tree, which is actually highlighted with this green color. Okay, so just what we need to do, we have to imagine this particular program, and then we have to draw this execution tree. So starting with the first node, as I said that initially we had x is greater than 0. Okay, so the node says x is greater than 0, and then it has a if statement a is equal to 1. It means it will go for let's say true branch, and then it will go for false branch. So true branch will be having, let's say, a equal to 1, and the false branch will be having a is not is equal to 1. Okay, then once we have this true branch and else branch, we are trying to store the constraint and which is highlighted in the red colors. Okay, so when you are let's say reached in the node 1, how many constraints are there? So constraints are x is greater than 0, and a equal to 1. So you are trying to store this constraint. Okay, let us move to the another if statement, which is b is equal to 1. So you're let's say, okay, what you did, if a is equal to 1, then you skipped, right? So from 1 you reach to node 2. Okay, you are at node 2 now. Now in node 2 you have if statement b is equal to 1, right? So again you have a let's say branch with the true and false branches. So b is equal to 1 will be the true branch, and b is equal to not is equal to let's say a false branch, right? Now you assume that you are taking the true branch. Okay, then up to let's say point number 3, this node number 3, how many constraints are there? X is greater than 0, equal to 0, equal to 1, and b is equal to 1. So three constraints are stored in this particular, let's say, node 3, right? Now what happens? You have another, let's say, what you need to do, c is equal to 0, you need to assign, right? So from 3 to 4, you have this assignment, the value 0 is going to assign to c, right? Now what happens? You are at node number 4, which is saying c is equal to 1. Okay, so again a branch, true branch and false branch. So c is equal to 1 and c is not is equal to 1. So c is equal to 1 is a true branch. But when you collected your constraint here, so what you have collected again, c is equal to 0 also gets stored in the constraint. So now what is your constraint? X is equal to 0, a equal to 1. Okay, I mean to say this one. Okay, X is greater than 0, equal to 1, B is equal to 1, and C is equal to 0. But what happens? As soon as it goes to the, let's say, this one, C is equal to 1, okay, which is actually incompatible with the constraint you are actually getting. So C is equal to 0 and C is equal to 1 cannot be possible together. It means this, but the further path will be infeasible. That's what actually here at node number 5, I have this cross mark. So this is the infeasibility of the path, right? And the way how we are actually proving is by sending it to the constraint solver, and constraint solver will see that whether it, the path is actually it has model or not. Okay, so this is the way how we prove infeasible path, and the paths which are like feasible, so it will be there, right? Now the question is that in dynamic symbolic execution, you are traversing the entire execution tree, but the thing is, it is not at all practical to explore the entire execution tree, right? So path explosion is the problem with dynamic symbolic execution, right? Now, utilizing this particular, let's say, infeasible path, we are actually finding some good formulas, okay? And we will try to see that how it can be helpful for our, let's say, interpolation mechanism. So what we did, we traversed, let's say this, imagine this is let's say, symbolic execution tree. So imagine that you traverse this particular subtree, right? And you learn something from that particular part. Then what will happen? If you have this particular program point, which is getting repeated on the right hand side of the execution tree, it means if it is A, okay, this is A1, let's say, and this is A2, right? Same program point, but you are, let's say, arriving there second time. Then what will happen? You have the possibility, you have the option of, let's say, subsuming it, because you already, let's say, traverse that same kind of code, and the second time again you are trying to go there. But if you do something like interpolation, then you will avoid, let's say, reaching that particular part. Okay, so you don't need to travel this. Now the question is, what exactly you need to have so that you will avoid traversal, right? So this is what learning. You went there, you learn. Now what happens? You come from top up to this particular point and try to map the, let's say, these states. Okay, if these two states are like implying each other, so you are able to say that, okay, no need to go there, because whatever the bugs are actually present in the particular subtree will definitely will get there as well. So no new bugs will be found there. So that is what the surety we will be getting with the interpolation algorithm. So this is what I was saying. What we need to do, that you have to save the prove the safety. And our safety is that to verify whether the X is greater than 0 is there at node number 6, okay? Because we started X is greater than 0 from the top, and you traverse here and there and reach at the point, and you will see that X has never been changed there, okay? So how you are going to, ensure the safety of this particular condition? So that's what actually we have to solve with this particular formula, let's say interpolation formula, right? So what you need to do, you have to traverse the tree based on, let's say, any strategy. You can use random strategy, depth first strategy, breadth first strategy, right? But in our particular tool, we prefer to go for depth first search because we start from the left and we are exhaustively going towards the right. In random, we did random also and we got some good result as well, but we prefer DFS because we are ensuring that when we are starting from a particular path so that we can scan till the last path. Okay, so anyhow, now our target is to verify that x is greater than 0 at the bottom. Then what kind of thing actually I can get from this let's say infeasible path, and then so that I can actually subsume this particular, let's say, part, this green color you are saying. So I need to do something with this particular node and this node so that I can actually subsume the path, right? So here is the let's say algorithm, that is what unset core let's say interpolation mechanism. So here you can see that what is unset core, actually this path, what actually we found this big path. So this is infeasible, okay? Infeasible unsatisfiability, you can understand, right? Unsatisfiability path. So you are actually finding what was the reason because of what actually this path is infeasible. That you have to find out, because this is a long path. It may have several constraints, but all the constraints may not be actually reason for the infeasibility. There must be some constraint which may have some, let's say, sense of infeasibility. So you can see that this underlying constraint, these are actually not required for unsatisfiability, but which are not, let's say, underlined, they are actually reasons. So I will show you how. What you do, you collect the path, okay? How to collect the path? You are starting from 0 to 5, okay? 0 to 5 you go, and then whatever the conditions you are getting there and along with the instruction, you just, let's say, store them, right? So this is what the path constraint you will be getting for the left path I was showing you. Now, what you need to do, you need to see that which are the, let's say, constraint which are actually causing the infeasibility. Then what you need to do, you know, this, you need to remove this particular guy, this guy, and this guy, and this one. Okay, now what you are left with, you are just only left with this c1 equal to 0 and c is equal to 1. You get this one, right? So you know, in a particular let's say path, all the conditions are in, let's say, conjunction, and conjunction will never be solved this particular problem. C1 is equal to 0 and C1 is equal to 1 cannot be possible. This is like unsatisfiability, right? And that is what the unset core we are calling it, and we are utilizing this particular formula so that we can let's say we can have some kind of computation so that we will be doing the subsumption. So what we did, again the same path, you are actually you found the infeasibility at node number 5. Okay, so now you are pushing back from there, and one by one you need to go, let's say branch by branch. Let's say you hit this particular node 5, then you are actually going back to node number 4. So it's only covering one branch, so it is called as half interpolant. Okay, other branch, you see, from 6 to 4 you are pushing it back to the 4. Okay, again you are saying this is half interpolant. So for a particular node, if you have two branches, okay, so half interpolant will come from the right hand side and half interpolant will come from the left hand side. Okay, so here it is infeasible, so it won't return anything, right? Then what it will return, it will return x is greater than 0 from this particular, because the path is safe and it has proved this particular guy is actually good there, right? Now you will throw this x is greater than 0 upward, and this also you are going to throw upward, right? Now both branches gone to 4, and by 4 it is gone to 3, and at node number 3 you have stored the full interpolant, okay, coming from two sub branches. Now the parallel node for this 3, you will be getting this particular node 4. Okay, what will happen? This is parallel because this is the one of the, let's say, children of node number 2. Okay, and then you need to go down to 4 and you need to see that, okay, whether the path is safe or not. The path is safe, you push back this half interpolant to 4. Okay, now what will happen? This 4 you are storing here, which is one of the children of 2, and you are storing this 3, which is one of the children of 2. Okay, now this full interpolant was actually because of 5 and 6, but now it became let's say half interpolant at 4, and then this full interpolant and full interpolant, this became let's say half interpolant for node number 2. You understood? I just tried to solve these subtree issues, and when I'm going to node number 2, I'm actually saying that whichever the full interpolant actually came until this nodes 3 and 4, they are now became half. And now when they became half, so merging them, they will become let's say full interpolant at node number 2. Okay, like this. So here I have this full interpolant, but full interpolant with what? Full interpolant with the formula x is greater than 0. This is what the interpolant I actually let's say got. Okay, x is equal to 0, because this particular property is safe. I proved it. Now what will happen? Assume that we have non-pruning system. Okay, that is dynamic symbolic execution, which is like a state of tool we can consider Cli. So what will happen? Why Cli is actually exploring the path? Let me tell you. If we are starting from 0 and we are reaching to this particular program point 2 and this program point 2, both are same. This A and B both are same. Okay. Now what will happen if let's say this one, right, without interpolation, I'm telling you, if I want to solve the problem, then what I will be having, x is greater than 0, this is constraint, and a is equal to 1. Okay, and what will be the context from right hand side? It will be x is greater than 0 and a is not is equal to 1. Okay, so this this particular things I will be having from left hand side and right hand side until this particular let's say node number 2. Okay, but what is the problem here? You can see x is greater than 0 and x is greater than 0, they are satisfying to each other. But what about this guy? A is equal to 1 and a is not is equal to 1, which is not actually satisfying to each other. And this is what we can say, that the left hand, the context of left hand side let's say constraint and the right hand side context of the right hand side branch, they are not implying each other. But if I want to utilize the interpolation thing, then what I will do, I will match the formula collected from the bottom up approach until this point number 2, and the context actually coming from this particular branch, okay, at point number 2, which is labeled as B. Now what will happen if I will be from left side, I have just only x is greater than 0, and right hand side I have this particular formula, x is greater than 0, x is greater than 0, and a is not is equal to let's say 1. Now what happens? X is greater than 0 and x is greater than 0. So it is somewhat like generalize the thing, because there is nothing to match with a is not is equal to 0. So it shows that this implies this particular constraint. This constraint is applying this, and this is what the let's say interpolation formula we are generating from let's say bottom up approach, and this is context coming from the top. And when this two formulas are implying each other in a way, so that we can say that the revisited program point is actually required to be subsumed and no need to traverse it. So this is what the logic behind let's say without interpolation and with interpolation. Now coming to the particular contribution of this talk, which actually I'm trying to present to you, this is iterative deepening. The problem actually we have observed that the some program are having infinite loop, and infinite loop cannot be solved very easily. So what we have to do is, first we will try to let's say solve the let's say program, let's say run the program with one bound, and whatever the interpolation we are going to compute, we will just store it. And then we will be incrementing our let's say another bound, let's say 1 plus 1 2, second bound, and then we will be going back to the program and then again generating the interpolant. And this interpolation and this interpolation formulas will get, you know, let's say collected, and so on. We will be going until let's say timeout, because this is infinite loop, we will not be able to finish it. But within the timeout, we will be able to show you that we have found more number of bugs in the program. Okay, so this is what, as soon as we will be going for the higher bounds, we will be getting more and more reachable bugs. So we are on top of CLI, means CLI is dynamic symbolic execution, and we are dynamic symbolic execution with pruning. So the main point is our interpolation formula. That's what actually we are coming from, CLI towards the TraceRx. Okay, now the experimental study. So we for this particular contribution, we have, set two settings. Okay, the first setting was only just run the programs with the TraceRx, okay, normal TraceRx, okay. And what we have found that the programs which actually we participated in the RERS 2020 challenge, it has, I think, nine or ten programs were there, okay. And there are some complex program, I will be showing the table as well. So every program has 100 targets, and we needed to find as many as we can actually find. And it has also the the logic of proving unreachable target. Now you understand, if you have infinite loop bound in the program, and the target is also to prove unreachable, so it makes very difficult task. But when we tried with only TraceRx, that we have found some result. So some labels are here. I will be showing the table. So if you will see. Hash target, this means total targets. R target means reachable targets. U target means unreachable targets. And unknown target means targets minus reachable target. The left targets are considered as unknown target. And one more thing, this U target, which are like unreachable target, only possible if no memory out or no timeout actually happens. Okay. Now, the idea of incremental deepening helps to explore the symbolic execution tree in a very good way. Okay, but we have observed three programs out of those nine programs I will be showing you, that problem 16, 18 and 19 were, very big program. I think problem 19 was 500,000 line of code. And it is very difficult to, find the bugs in that particular, program. So a non-pruning DSC faces difficulty to explore, but if we consider our approach, then we will be able to find the more and more reachable bugs in less time. So total 191 reachable targets actually have been proved out of maybe 900 something. Now second setting, what was the second setting? That since our target was to also prove unreachable target, right? So what we did, we have plugged FRAMC, which is a abstract interpretation tool, and they have claimed as a sound tool. Okay, so what we have done, we have ran all those programs with FRAMC first, and we have proved absence of bug. 100 targets are there. So if FRAMC is not alarming those targets, it means the FRAMC has proved them as unreachable. Then we have removed those bugs from the program, and then we only targeted for the alarmed one. And alarmed one may have reachable and may have unreachable, and then our targets got lesser, and we did something better as compared to the setting one. Okay, so idea was FRAMC and TraceRx together we wanted to use. So this is what the thing I got here. You can see that we have ran problems 11 to 19. It is from the RERS 2020 challenge. And we have found that these numbers 32, 51, 73, 51, and so on. Okay, these are alarms raised by FRAMC. Okay, for the problems 11 to 19 respectively. Now, as we know, FRAMC is a sound tool. So we proved unreachable target, right? So what were the our unknown target means we wanted to target? These were targets minus alarm, whatever the alarms we got it here, right? So this particular raised alarms are called as now hard target, and our idea was to target them only. So this is the table where you can see the RERS benchmark program for 2020 challenge. You can see that the problem 19 is something 500,000, and problem 18 is 100,000. And this 16 is 113,000. So you can see the complexness of the problems are quite good, and all the benchmark they have 100 targets. And this is the thing actually we got. Let's say our target is reachable target we found here, 18, 13, 22, 15, and so on. Okay. And this unreachable target we have actually proved using, let's say, Framasi, right? Now, let's say the number of unknown target can be computed as the target we proved, let's say, this, let's say, unreached, unreached target minus, let's say, plus reached target and targets whatever we are having, these are like unknown. Means there are some targets which we are not able to say anything about them. Okay, so such targets are also there. So a total number of 460 targets actually we got, and 269 actually proved as unreachable, and 191 actually we proved as, let's say, reachable targets. Okay, so we found that for RDRS kind of program, and if such programs are having infinite loop, then combination of Framasi plus TracerX is actually solving the thing. Okay, and we participated in the sequential reachability, let's say, track, and we stood actually second rank there. And we participated in three categories, let's say plain, arithmetic, and arrays categories. And we got this result. As you can see, that only one, let's say, the winner had 718 point, and we had 714 point. So we lost with 4 points. So if we could have, let's say, proved some 4 to 5 more bugs, something, let's say, in unreachable or reachable, something happened with the minor mistake actually we made. That's why actually we are not able to get the 4 more points. Otherwise we were very close to that. So that's what actually this ranking says, that we stood second, and you can see that the others are having 683 points, 312 points, and 248 points. So most probably few of them actually have not used abstract interpretation, and few of them actually have used abstract interpretation. And the detail category of the points are actually there in the table. So yeah, and our let's say tool, this is available in our website. You just visit and you can enjoy the tool and you can use for your work. Thank you, and I can take questions now.
Thank you, Sangu. So if anyone has question, please raise hands.
Sangharata, this is Deepak here.
Yeah, hi.
So there are similar ideas like that have been used in, for example, the Synergy tool from Microsoft. You know, Aditya Nori and Sriram and all had a. So there, the idea was also to do this kind of combined search for a counter example, as well as a search for a proof, right? So you try to do both, like what you're doing using Framasi as well as symbolic execution. Have you looked at that kind of work?
Not really, but external. See, our main idea was not that to utilize Framasi, just we wanted to make sure that the the absence of bug we can able to prove. So that is what the thing, but I think I will be looking at that particular thing. Yeah. But these tool combinations actually we found suitable. Yeah. But what about the work they are doing, this interpolation or what?
They use some kind of I think they have to use
Rajamani's work? Is it Rajamani's work?
Yeah, yeah. Aditya Nori and
Okay. Then Yogi
tool
is there. Yeah, yeah. We are there. Mm-hmm. And recently we have distinguished our paper with that. Yeah, similar work is there. Right.
Yeah, so Synergy was, I think, the predecessor of Yogi.
Yeah. But we have modern technology, by the way. Means I showed you unsat core, but we have weakest precondition as well as custom interpolation. Just after 30 minutes, I have presentation in ISTA. So we modified the interpolation algorithm also, and we have custom interpolation as well for MCD. So some parts actually we are having a little similar concept.
Okay, and this Framasi is purely automatic? I mean, or do you have to give some invariants by the user?
For Framasi?
Yeah.
Yeah, Framasi is like what had happened. Let's say the programs had assert 0, okay, as a target. So what I did, I removed assert 0 and I replaced it with division by 0. Let's say kappa division by 0. So I considered that if one kappa division by zero is actually I'm able to get right division by zero alarm, it is equivalent to asset zero. And I'm trying to find out whether that location is absent, let's say, reachable or not. Like, but it is automatic. It is automatic.
So what is it? Which domain does it use? Does it use some like octagons or polyhedral? I mean, what is the what? Which abstract domain did you use?
That I'm not sure. Means I used the static analyzer as a black box. Just we wanted to utilize it, like you know, supply the program, and just we wanted to know whether it is reachable or unreachable. So internal thing of static analyzer for particularly from us, I am not aware about much of it.
Okay. So by default, it may be using some.
Correct. Correct.
Okay.
Just I have flagged the division by zero, let's say, option, and I was able to raise division by zero, let's say, warnings.
Yeah.
And I utilized that.
Okay.
So the idea actually came from CBMC, and we usually compare our work with CBMC. So CBMC has, you know, internal abstract interpretation first, and then it trying to find out the things.
Okay.
So we wanted to make it like that only, but externally. See, Framas is plugging with TracerX externally. It is somewhat same, internal or external. So ultimately, you do the job with the static analysis first, then you start your main job. That is what.
Okay.
So any other questions? So if not, thank you, Sangu. And so I would like to thank all the speakers for this session. And special thanks to everyone, because we started 5 minutes after 9, and we are closing our session 5 minutes past 11. So everyone stick to the timing. And thank you to all the audience also. Maybe everyone can switch on their videos for a second or two, so that we get a nice snapshot here, as many as possible. I don't know if it will come in the recording or not. Yeah, quite a few camera shy people, I think. Okay. So, yeah, thank you, everyone. So, next session starts in about 15 minutes, right, Balwinder? So I hand it over to you if you have any announcements, and then
yeah, thank you. Thank you, Amay, for chairing the